I want to introduce Joy Kane, the curator of the exhibit as I said up front, and Jay Whitaker. I'm very honored to have you both here, particularly you, Jay, and I'm excited to hear your conversation.
And I want to thank everybody for coming out tonight to hear Jay and I talk about Jay's life. One of the things that I did mention to Jay earlier was this isn't just about Janis Joplin, that Jay herself, having been a lesbian woman who moved here during the Beat period, her life is really fascinating. So that's what we're going to be looking at tonight and talking about. We will, of course, also talk about Janis. So to start, I guess what I'd like you to talk a little bit about is like where you were from, where you grew up, you know, a little bit about your childhood.
Well, hi, folks. Well, I was born in Brooklyn, New York. And my mother and father separated when I was about 4 or 5, at a time when I had gone to Virginia and had a bike accident. My 12-year-old cousin was riding his bicycle and I was sitting on the back of the bicycle, and I told him to stop because I was tired of holding my legs out, and he didn't stop, so I dropped my left foot and the spokes, you know, just kind of chewed it up. And so my mother rushed me back to New York because she didn't want to take me to a doctor down there. This, you know, this is 1942, 43. So she gets me back there, and they tell her that they would have to amputate because the time had caused it gangrene to set in. So she didn't do that. She is apparently some West Indian lady heard her plight, and she told him about this doctor. Mm. And here I am walking.
All right.
Thank God for that. Anyway, that was my beginning. Then my mother met this guy named Roy Pittman after my father left when I was in this condition, by the way. And he was from North Carolina. At this time, I'm about 5, going on 6. So they hooked up. I told my mother, I said, Mom, I said, I want to call him Daddy. So my mother said, okay. So she married him. So I called him Daddy. I don't know how many years. So in all his life, actually. Then we went to Virginia, North Carolina, and we did that for the next 10 years off and on. We stay a year in North Carolina, sharecropping, picking cotton, peanuts, the whole rap thing, like they do. And when the end of the year came, there was no money to be had. We had used it all, heating it up in the man's store. So Daddy would then get us all together, and we would shuck corn one night, as much as we could for like 2 nights, we would shuck corn to get corn to take it to the market so we can get about $200 or $300 to take the bus back to New York. And we did that 2 or 3 times. So anyway, that's my younger years. And when I was about 14 or 15, my stepfather's uncle raped me. So my mother sent me to my father, who was in New York. And that's where I went to high school and blah, blah, blah. At the time, I was always in love with the teachers. Yeah. I have dreams about the teachers. I love the teachers. So I think I known very early on that I was attracted to women.
One of the questions was, when did you start to realize that you were a lesbian or that you were different from the
Well, actually, I can remember, you know, 5 or 6 years old, always being attracted to pretty women. So I guess that's when I knew.
Great.
Yeah. When I actually met a woman, I was about 20 years old. I was in New York. By the way, I finished high school in New York, went to art school. And I was going with guys because I was definitely straight. I mean, this was all in my head about being gay. So this guy said, you know, he said, you're gay. I said, well, what do you mean I'm gay? I'm not gay. He said, no, you're a lesbian. I said, well, I think you're wrong. He said, no. He said, this woman I was in art school, she really wants to get to know you. Well, I was scared to death. I said, no way. So I did not. And then I met this lady who told jokes. I just loved her. I just worshipped her. She took me to this party and told me this other woman was attracted to me. And I just went, oh my God. The feeling that came over me, I could not believe. It was amazing, you know. So I couldn't wait to get to this woman. And I couldn't how I came out. And that's the story.
Around what year was that?
This was in 1960. Well, actually, no. That's not the whole truth, nothing but the truth. It was actually 59. I just got out of school, high school. And then I met this woman named Polly Atwater, who happened to be a white lady. And I saw her across the street, and she saw me. And then we went zing, zing. And we came to San Francisco together. That's how I got here.
So when you were in New York, were you already kind of interested in, you were going to art school.
Right.
You were kind of aware of the beat scene, what was going on?
Well, in New York, I kind of used to, we used to hang out in the Village. And I used to drink, red wine on the corners of New York, you know, because that's what we did. And go in the bars, you know. It was so amazing in New York in the Village because, you know, you saw all these people there like Mose Allison, Thelonious Monk. I mean, you could just see them for nothing. You just go and have a drink, you know. So that was kind of like my New York years.
So you were already, were you playing any instruments?
I was not playing any instruments.
Yeah,
only in my head.
In your head.
Yeah.
So what drew you to San Francisco? What made
you
decide to leave New York?
Well, I fell in love with this woman.
Ah, okay.
And she said, we're going to San Francisco.
Got it.
So I said, okay. So I went. I was living with this writer and this actress, and there was three of us there as roommates. So I came in and I said, "Well, I'm going to San Francisco." They said, "Uh-huh." Okay, I'll see you guys. I packed up my little suitcase and everything, and she had this woman named Polly Atwater. I just heard that she died about 2 or 3 years ago. She was a fantastic artist. I mean, this woman could draw anything. But what she drew was a New York driver's license seal. Seal. And then she stole all these checks. And went to cash them and put the seal in. Do you want all this information?
Sure.
Well, anyway. She got all this money for us to catch a bus to come to San Francisco. However, we ran out of money in Denver, Colorado.
Ah.
So we stayed in Denver for almost a year. Now, this was 1960 when we left. Stayed in Denver for that year and worked at the Jewish National Home for Asthmatic Children. And we had a living job there. We were making $50 a month. But we had free food and bed, so we saved up a lot of money. Bought this old car and we drove out to San Francisco.
So where were you hanging out in the lesbian bars in Colorado?
Well, the thing is,
were there lesbian bars?
There were lesbian bars. There was very, in other words, blacks were not accepted too well there, you know what I mean? And I was kind of like the fly in the buttermilk type thing everywhere I went. And but you know, we made it, you know, and finally came out here. And when I got out here, I was surprised. We came out here and we stopped at this place called the Hour Club, which was on Pacific and Leavenworth. And we were saying, well, we need a place to stay. Well, maybe somebody will take you down on Polk Street, but you know, black and whites can't get a place here in San Francisco. I mean, I was really surprised.
Yeah.
So we kind of slept in our car for about 2 or 3 days, and then this lady down on 3rd Street said that we got this little cottage in the back, so that's where we finally got a place. And then she had never been with a woman or stayed with a woman for more than a year. I was with her for a year and a week. So I was left here by myself, not knowing what to do, where to go. Everything. So, let me see. I got this little apartment on, I think it was Oak Street. Yes, on Oak Street. And then I had got a couple of roommates. And we made it. And then we decided, I started seeing this woman who had this nice house over on State Street over here. And she was, she did bugs. She put bugs on pens and she had lots of bugs. And it was kind of creepy, but I liked her house. they decided to move out, and I got the place. Directly across the street now from where I moved in 62. And I missed some part there. I'm in this house and I'm with these Filipino fellow and an Indian fellow and my friend Nancy and myself. And we go out on the weekends to Geno's and Carlos, all these places in North Beach. And when the bars closed, we would go to this place called the Tay Bush, which was on Taylor and Bush. Mm-hmm. And it was a hamburger place. But everybody who was in knew about this hamburger place because you could dance. So after 2 o'clock, we would go over there and we'd order this fantastic hamburger, mm-hmm. cheeseburger, and we would dance. So I got in there and I said, Jamie, I said, order me a cheeseburger. I gotta go to the bathroom. So they had this unisex bathroom. Walked up the stairs. I was about the 3rd or 4th in line, went to the bathroom. When I came out, you could hear a pin drop. And I said, now something is wrong. Well, there, the lights were flooding and there were about 13 paddy wagons. And this was 1962 because this fellow named Christopher. He was the mayor. He's going to clean up San Francisco. So I got in that thing, busted 103 of us. They would say, who's your father? Who's blah, blah, blah. They didn't ask me, but they were asking some people. And you know, doctors, Indian chiefs, and all those people, they let them go. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And they took 103 of us to jail.
Wow. So how long were you in jail?
Oh, all night long. All night. Not all night. I would say just at 3 o'clock in the morning. 7:00 or 8:00 in the morning.
How did someone come to bail you out?
Yes, a lady from the place I came to in San Francisco, the Hour Club on Pacific, came and bailed us all out.
Wow.
Yeah. The women, anyway. The men's, I think the men, the club, the Hour Club was on, as I said, Pacific, and on High, there was a bar called, I think, Rick's, but I'm not positive about that. That's where the guys hung out at most of the time. And I think Rick's got them out. So. And then we went to court 6-7 times, and somebody finally took the rap, and they let us all go. But I was scared to death because I just got this job in the cleaners. Oh my God, I got a job, you know? And there's my face on the front page. And you can see me really good because I was surrounded by a lot of people. Exactly about. Yeah, so.
So was the Art Club, was it an integrated bar, or when you showed up, was it integrated?
Well, there were blacks. I mean, yeah. you would find one of us, you know, just kind of like this audience, you know. Sharp. And this is 1963. And I guess you guys know Howard Hesseman.
Yes.
Okay. He and all the people from the committee would come into Gino's and Carlos and the Anxious Asp and the Coffee Gallery, and all these bars around there. We would go from bar to bar to bar to bar. And so one day, excuse me, Godfrey, Linda Godfrey, and Janice, I think they were roommates or something like that. Excuse me. So I really liked Linda Godfrey. I thought she was really cute. And there's a fellow named Mark Evans. Mark Evans was from, let's see if I can remember the state. Anyway, Midwest there somewhere. Little Rock. From Little Rock, Arkansas. And he just dressed impeccably. He was just so cool, you know. And I said, I really like that Linda. He said, what the fuck's wrong with you? It's Janice you should be going with. I said, Janice? I said, but I don't know if I like her. He said, well, here, take a pill, like her. Anyway, we go to a party that night at Howard Hesseman's place. And we're smoking, you know, drinking and blah, 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 blah. And, Janice kind of sashayed over to me and said a few words, and I said a few words, and then we started kissing, and I said, well, that's how it happened. So within about 2 weeks, she was living with me. That's how we got started. Yeah.
Before we get totally into Janice, did you have any experiences with any of the other beat folks at Ginsberg or any of those?
Well,
folks?
Ginsberg, there was a fellow named Kanai. He was a Filipino fellow that had an apartment about as real small. But he had a big round bed. He had a little kitchenette. And after 2:00 in the morning, when we were in North Beach, we would go up to Kanai's house. I can't even believe I remember that name. So Ginsberg would be there, all Ferengetti would be there, all these people would be there, and we'd be continuing drinking and eating cheese and smoking grass. And I guess I've slept with Ginsberg about 3 or 4 times. But I mean, we're on the bed, and we might just kind of fall out. Ginos was a wonderful place. I just loved Ginos. It was an Italian bar. I'm not going to talk more than that.
Yes.
I don't know how they are now.
Are they still in existence?
Oh, yes. They've been in existence since 1947.
We'll go check them out.
Everybody who owned it at the time are dead, and they're dead now, but
yeah.
The children's still on it.
So the bars you're going to, were they exclusively lesbian?
Never exclusively lesbians. Lesbians couldn't afford to have an exclusive bar.
That's right.
Kind of
like now.
Yeah.
Right.
So we went to the guys' bars more than the guys came to our bars. But in North Beach, everybody went everywhere, straight, gay, didn't matter. Everybody mixed in with each other.
So that was actually one thing I had is in researching the exhibit and stuff, I started to realize that, and we talked about it a little bit earlier, in a way the Beat seemed much more open to homosexuality. It was sort of more open to strong women than what came along later
right.
with the hippie.
Right. Yeah, well, I didn't consider myself an elite. I consider myself more than a hippie for some reason.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I dress more hippie.
And that was in the early 60s.
Yeah, this was in the early 60s. Yeah. There was a lot of jazz going on back then too.
Yeah.
You know, there was a jazz place. I don't remember the name, but there was a fellow named Jim Lowe. He was just an excellent pianist, and he played jazz and. You know, we'd go hang out there. Whoever had a show, that's where we were. For the entertainment.
Okay, so we'll move up to Janice. So you meet Janice at Gino and Carlos?
I meet Janice at Gino and Carlos shooting pool.
And you take a pill.
And I take a pill.
And you left us where you'd kiss.
Well, actually, I couldn't tell you about this pill. This is true. I was shooting pool, Janice was shooting pool, Janice was over there, and Mark says, take this pill. I said, well, I'm going home. No, you take this pill. So I took the pill, and the last thing I remember is that I was stroking this ball, and I laid on the table, and when I woke up, I was at this party. And that's the truth. And that's where Janice and I got hooked up that same night at this party.
God.
So anyway, she moved in and we had this short affair type of thing. And she didn't want anybody to know that she was gay. So she never let a picture be taken with us together. And she... Even though everybody in our crowd knew that we were together, when it came to, you know, like walking down the street, she was just very uptight, you know, the whole thing. So so when I said the Filipino guy, the Indian guy, my friend Nancy, myself, and then Janice moved in with us at the same house across the street from where I live now. And she didn't have a job and she didn't have money. And I said, well, Janice, I can't take care of it. You know, I said, you're going to have to get a job. She said, well, what am I going to do? I said, type. So so she went out and got a job typing. She didn't like it, but she did it. I mean, we had to pay out $17.50 a month, each of us. You know, $85 a month rent. So we all met for the 17th.
So what, was she, and let me just check, can people hear in the back? Is the mic working?
Yes.
Okay. So was she doing music at this time? Was she singing?
Yes, that was a matter of fact. Thank you for reminding me. When we were together, we did a lot of Cough Gallery. She was singing Hootenannies and get us drinks. And we would go down to Monterey, I think Selma? What is this place down there called Selma or something?
Salinas.
You know?
Salinas.
They had music down there too. And she would go there and sing and win, you know, tickets. We'd go to the main arena there in Monterey. She would sing the Hootenannies on the stage and get us tickets to the main arena. And we really had a good time.
Yeah.
So she walks up. So she loved Bob Dylan. Ah, God, did she love that guy. So when we first kind of got together, I'm in this, in her apartment before she moves in with me. She said, I got somebody I want to turn you on to. I said, who is it? She said, Bob Dylan. Who is Bob Dylan? Well, you just listen, okay. So she turns on this, whatever they had back then.
Record,
okay. And he started saying, how many rooms? And I said, how old is this guy? She said, he's 21. And he came up with a song called The Lonesome Death of Hattie Carroll. And I started crying like I could not control it. Just talking about it makes me tear up. I don't know if you guys know the story. Okay, everybody knows the story. Well, if you don't
know the story.
I don't know the story. Thank you.
Okay. Well, when I was in New York, before I left New York in 1958, a story came out in the newspaper about this tobacco farmer killing his maid with a cane. And she had 10 children. And so, of course, we know that anybody that has any money and happens to be of white skin is not going to get any time. That's what we felt. So, sure enough, he got a 6-month sentence or suspended sentence. I don't know which is a 6-month sentence, suspended sentence. But anyway, Bob Dylan put that story so succinctly in this song is that it just ripped my heart out. And I said, well, I love this man, and I still do. I think he's a genius, you know, I just love Bob Dylan. So that's the story of The Lonesome Death of Hattie Carroll. And she turned me on to him, and I thank you for that today. Mm. Yeah.
So the two of you were going to Hootenannies and the folk festivals,
right,
such as they were. Right. What, and what kind of, were you playing music?
No, I was
yet?
Not.
Not yet.
No. Okay. I mean, used to sing at the jukebox.
Uh-huh.
You know, if it's anything was playing at the jukebox, whatever song happened to be that we both knew, we would sing it together. And that's kind of was our attraction too. And of course, you know, I mean, we were rebels, you know. She was white and I'm black, and we'd have to get together. You know, just that type of thing. We had that mindset.
You
heard
about meeting Bob Dylan.
Oh, yes. Yeah, Bob Dylan. So anyway, she loved Bob Dylan. And so you see him on the grounds at the Monterey Festival. And she walked up and she said, Oh, Bob, she said, oh, I just love you so much. She said, I'm going to be famous too one day. He said, yeah, we all going to be famous. Yeah, we know, you know. I guess he remembered later on. Yeah.
So one of the to talk a little more about your relationship with Janice, but any insight you might have about Janice's perception about the lesbianism?
Well, Janice, I think Janice was a bisexual or a lesbian, but I don't think she would ever say that she was, as long as she was alive, to anybody that would know. Because she was embarrassed about it. She was embarrassed that she had these feelings. And so that's why I say she never wanted a picture taken of me. I think she had pictures taken of Peggy Pissarro, because she looked very straight, basically. You know, looked hippie type of thing, and, you know, they could hang together. But I would say that every show that Janice was in that I went to, she would always acknowledge me and sing a song. It's dedicated to Jay Wood. I appreciate that, for sure.
The way I actually discovered Jay was I read this, the best biography of Janice Joplin. If you're looking for one, it's called Scars of Sweet Paradise by a woman named Alice Eckel. She's a feminist historian, she's great. I discovered Jay in this, then I saw the biography that PBS did, and I thought, oh my God, Jay is actually still alive. And I work over at Rainbow Grocery, and one day a friend of mine was in there, and I said to her, oh yeah, you know, I'm doing this exhibit, I'm looking, she said, oh, I know Jay. And literally, we got connected through this friend of ours who shops over at Rainbow. But in the book, it does state that she kind of thought that Janice kind of hid her lesbianism because she wanted to be famous.
She wanted
and
to
was
be
afraid of lesbianism.
That's right. She wanted to be famous. And also, she wanted that little White House with a picket fence. But she also chose guys who were motorcycle riders of dirty, greasy hair, mustache. You know, he showed all these guys that were just from the bottom, you know, the rags. Not to say that everybody that rides a motorcycle has a mustache at the bottom, but these guys were. She liked the excitement of the He-Man type of outlaw. That's what she was into at the time. So I was into her, I said, I don't know how you're gonna get this picket fence, Janice. You know, I cannot give you a baby. You know, and I said the guys you pick is—they're terrible. You know, I said, well, that's my thing. But you're right about that. Yeah.
So did she ever bring the guys back to your place, or did she go off?
Well, there was a once upon a time. There were people called the Hell's Angels. Well, we would get together on Sunday. They would come up to that same house. And we would play cards and dice and all this kind of stuff. And, you know, she liked that.
They were coming over to your
my house.
On State Street.
On State Street. Yeah. I guess she was riding with some of those guys or something. I don't remember how they even got to my house, but that's what happened. Yeah. But I wish I could say more about our relationship, but this, you know.
Well, you told me one time about riding in the Volkswagen over in
Miami. Oh, yeah. So,
this says
so we go over to Mule Woods, and I had this old 49G Willys. And I used to want to see just how many miles I could get from the gallon. So Janice says, Jane, get some gas. I said, I think we can make it. So actually, we did make it there, coming back. Stop. She said,
you asshole, blah, 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 blah.
I said, that's okay. Somebody will pick us up, we'll go get some gas. So she said, well, nobody's gonna pick us up, you being black and me being white. I said, well, I'm not gonna hide behind the trees.
Oh,
there together to pick you up, they're going to pick me up. Because if you stand out there and I run out from behind the tree, that's deception. And they might not like that. So, you stood out there, this hippie guy came along and took them and went, got some gas and everything. She bitched the whole way there, all the way back. I used to do dumb things like that sometimes. It took me a while to grow up and, you know, get some gas in the car when it's down.
We'll get there eventually. Yes. Let's stick with this period when you're still running
right.
out of gas.
Right.
So you and Janice were living together. Were you seeing other women? Was she seeing
other women? No. I've never been that type of woman.
Yes.
I've seen one woman at a time. She was seen, I'm sure. I mean, she and Linda Poole went to New York while we were together. Now, I don't know if she got in with Linda Poole or not. I think because of our friendship, Linda Poole was always kind of timid to say that they did. But they may have, they may not have. I don't know. But Janice got around. So I'll tell you another time. When Janice and I broke up, she was supposed to meet me at this particular place. And I waited for like an hour, 15 minutes, and she didn't show up. So I knew exactly where to find her. She was at the coffee counter, sitting there, laughing, talking, drinking. And I walked in and says, what's this all about? I mean, you were supposed to meet me. You don't even have the decency to let me know you're not coming by calling or something like that. So she said, I said, don't fuck with me. So anyway, she got up and ran behind the bar. And they said, Janice, get from behind the bar. Get from behind the bar. So I ran behind the bar too. I said, I want you to come outside and talk to me. I wasn't going to hit her or anything like that. But I want you to respect me enough to come outside and talk to me and tell me what the hell is going on. You know, are we breaking up or what is going on? She hadn't said anything to me. So we got outside and she said, yeah, I just want to move. I want to move into a place by myself. And I said, okay, fine. I'll help you move, which is what I did. You know, so that's how we broke up. But we remained friends. I met another woman named Suzanne Smith. She met this guy from England who used to wear a Sergeant Pepper Lonely Heart Club Band jacket. And they were into drugs. And she would call me up once in a while and said, Jay, she said, I really need some money. I don't have anything to eat. So Suzanne and I would go over there and give her $20. We know it wasn't food, but we'd give her $20. So this happened maybe 3-4 times or something like that. After she became famous, I was in North Beach and she was in the coffee gallery again. I said, hey, Jay. When she got her car, she came over to my house and we went out for a ride and everything. But this is a few years later. I'm sitting in the coffee gallery. She comes in and says, I said, hey, Janice. I said, well, how about buying me a drink? She said, well, you never did anything for me.
Oh.
And I said, how fast we forget. She said, oh, I was just joking, Jay. I was just joking. Now, what do you want? But her first reaction was the real one. Because she thought people was always after her for her money. She knew that I wasn't. So I think that's why she changed her behavior. So that was kind of my relationship with her. So it wasn't that long and it wasn't that intense. So we stayed friends, as I said, and she got with this guy. And the next Thanksgiving, we went down to Princeton, her with her Englishman and me and Suzanne, and we had cooked some type of meat over this fireplace that was turning black. It was just a mess, but we had a good time.
So it was my understanding that sort of around, I guess, 64, 65 maybe,
uh-huh.
Janice started to become really strung out and speak.
Yeah, well,
and
see, I was out.
You weren't around.
I couldn't handle drugs.
Yes.
I just never could handle drugs. I didn't want to be drugs around me.
Except this pill.
But that was not for her.
Oh, you didn't do any of her drugs?
No, I didn't do any of her drugs. We smoked grass, but that was about it, you know. No, I just, it made me queasy. I think it happened when I was in New York before all this happened. I went to this party and this guy was in this Stetson hat, white t-shirt, white drawers, and he had garter belt on his socks. And he was sitting there with a cigarette burning himself. And it made my flesh crawl.
Yeah.
You know. So that's one of the reasons I didn't stand people shoot up. Yeah.
So you're holding up?
I'm only up fine.
So you got another girlfriend?
So I got Suzanne.
Suzanne.
Yes. And we lived together for 11 years. So we bought the house that I'm in right now. That was in 74. Janice was gone by then.
Yeah.
We got this place called Friends and Relations Hall, which Chet Helms owned this place out on the Great Highway. It's on the old family golf. So we, 10 of us, got together and put $2,000 each to get this hall from Chet. And so we did. And we put on all kind of shows there. And we did Tommy. I don't know if you heard of Tommy. And we did Quicksilver, Kevin Airplanes, all these people, you know, Crosby, Stills and Nash, Sons of Chapman, all these people, Ray Slate. But we never made any money. And they decided to tear the building down because they were going to build high rise or do something out there at the beach. And the lot's still there, empty. And this lot used to, Art and Linkletter, back in the 40s, early 40s, when they had these dance marathons, people would dance, and he was the narrator there, whatever you want to call it. They would dance, and this place held 2,000 people.
Wow.
It was a big place, and it had rooms upstairs, about six rooms upstairs, that used to be a brothel. And downstairs, there was a long kitchen along Great Highway that they sold fried chicken.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Was this place part of Playland at the beach?
Yes.
It was part of Playland.
Only it was the father's building going up the hill, just before the
yeah, it was the northwest corner.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Thank
yeah.
you very much.
So you actually, so tell a little bit more. So were you around in the hate when the hate was happening in 67?
I wasn't too much in the hate itself. I would say, I went down there, stuff like that. I was more in the park,
Mm-hmm.
When they had concerts in the park, I was always there. I've never missed that.
Uh-huh.
But to hang on the street, they were a little too dirty for me.
Yeah.
I was up in
So you and Suzanne, were you hanging out at North Beach?
We were North Beach, and then there was the Wild Side West. Well, that came. The Wild Side West used to be in Oakland, and it burned down. And then she bought a place. There used to be a topless place on Broadway with the girls dancing. So she bought that. And they used to have entertainment there too. So we would make the rounds of Geno's and Carlos, the Wild Side West, all these bars. That's what we did all day long till 2 o'clock in the morning. Then we went to somebody's house and party. And on Sunday we had hangovers, and we tried to get ourselves ready to go to the cleaners. I got to the post office by then. I'm making big money.
So, yeah.
$2.68 an hour.
So you eventually started working for the post office.
I started working for the post office in 1966, And I just got out of there in 1999.
Wow.
And then I took off a year and in 2000 went to work for the Giants. Go Giants. And I'm still with the Giants. And that's been 17 years. I cannot believe it. 17 years. I mean, time just flies.
What do you do for it?
I'm in guest services, you know, where you have complaints or you go there and get a free cold coffee or hot chocolate or whatever, you know, wheelchair, things like that.
So you also play music?
I do play a little bit of the guitar, very little.
Very little?
Mm-hmm.
But you're in a trio?
I still do. We're what you call upper mediocre. I'm a star. Yeah, but I love it. I really do. I'm into Daft Punk now.
Okay, well, if you're okay with it, we can open it to folks in the audience if people have questions.
Yes.
Do you remember how your foot was treated by that doctor at Safeway?
You know, I was 4 years old, and I really don't. I know he put a lot of mixed, it looked like, if I can remember, it was kind of black looking, salve or something like that, and he did a lot of washing and stuff like that, and I don't really remember too well, but I do remember that. Yeah. Yes.
So when, that period, that 4 or 5 years after you broke up, and before she was notable, you
right.
know, Monterey Pop.
Right.
And,
but that I forgot to say that.
Okay.
That night with Monterey Pop, when she did that, came out.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And so we all went to dinner that night. They paid for Suzanne and I dinner that night, the whole band and her.
Nice.
And she got some salad or something like that, and she was stoned out. Then we went up to her hotel room and we got stoned and everything like that. It was fun.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you experienced her from go out and get a job, you know, at a typist, to
right.
You know,
right.
A famous.
I don't believe, see, I never believed that she was going to be that famous, to be honest. I was shocked.
Yeah.
I mean, but what she did, I was just really proud of her. I mean, I just loved her. I was just so happy. I mean, she sings Summertime, I mean, bring tears to you.
Yeah.
She was really good. And when she used, without the screaming voice, when she used her natural voice, I mean, couldn't touch it.
Chris, and then
I wonder if you have any memories, or did you participate at all in the civil rights movements in the early, in 64?
Well, I was never really political. You know, I let other people do it for me.
Did you ever have
I'm
to run?
Sorry,
did
but
you run into any
true.
Of those sit-ins that were going on during that time? Did just
I did go, what I did one time, they got me on in the court, and they did something, this person had done something, sit-in or done something, and this lady got up and said, I think that she should be put under the jail, and I raised my hand. This was to get out of court. This is what this was all about. And I said, and I think that the jury should be put under the jail.
Huh.
So they said, dismiss. That's how we got out of it. So the thing is, as far as being in movements or something like that, I didn't do it. But when I came into contact with somebody and I did it as an individual. I didn't do it as a group. Yes.
Did you keep up with her up until the time that she died?
I tell you what, I did keep up with her to say every time she came in town or visit her over here at her place that she lived. But my girlfriend and I were going to open up a store that he's working in now, something like that. So I was going to get $5,000 for Janice, I don't know if I would have got the money or not. I was waiting for her to come back to town to get in contact with her, because I knew she trusted me,
right.
You know. And I got a feeling that she would have done it, but she never came back to town.
What do you think she'd be doing if she was still around with us today?
Drinking.
Yeah.
No, I don't know, maybe she's okay. Yes, yeah, probably, but it's kind of hard to say, who knows? You know, she was very...
Because Gracie Slick is still around, and some of the rest of those people that are still around, and there's still some smart people okay.
Yeah, you mean like David, Getz, people like that? Yeah, they are. I don't know what she would have done. You just never know. I don't know. I can't say. She was very smart.
I've been to her place, the museum that they have dedicated to her in Port Arthur, Texas.
Uh-huh.
And I know she did a lot of stuff in the Austin music scene, and
right.
So she's really
yeah.
popular
uh-huh.
in that part of the country as well. And I've been a huge fan of her from the first time I heard her sing.
Fantastic. Yeah, that's great. Yeah, me too. When she made it, I mean, when she was singing new things, I said, how is she winning like this all the time, you know?
She was an experience.
Yes, she was.
She was.
Four ways
in
one.
Yeah. I'm just wondering if you remember the first time where you were when you first heard her on the radio or something like that, where you really were like, oh, she made it.
I think the first song I heard her do on the radio was Busted Platinum. That one. But I had seen her so many times, you know. But that I think that was, if I can remember, I'm not sure about that. Yes.
Hi. One thing.
Well, like I said, when I left New York and went to Denver, Colorado, it was very hard to find a place, and it was frustrating. But me being been through the fields and everything of North Carolina and Virginia, you might say that it didn't surprise me. I didn't feel put out because I was already used to it. You know, it's just that you do what you do.
You knew your place.
Exactly. You know, seriously, it's just that when you're in the times, you do what you do in the times, you know what I mean, to make it through. And I never took it personal because I always had a big ego, you know, an arrogance that, you know, you're not really calling me a nigger. You're the nigger for calling me a nigger, you see. That's the way I took it. Yes?
About your travel cross country. I know in that period of time, hotels did not open themselves up to blacks.
That's true.
So as a woman, did you have to stay in your car all night and worry about if someone's going to attack you? Or I mean, what?
I didn't really worry about attacking so much. I did, and when I was in New Mexico, I did. We were even chased there. There was one time we were on this highway. I shouldn't say this. This is before. We were in Denver, Colorado. And there was a highway, and there was a big drop there about maybe 300 to 400 feet. And this big truck came along and saw the two of us on black and white and tried to slide us over. And I was driving. And I realized what he was doing. As I looked in my rearview mirror and saw it on my side, I saw what he was doing. So when he was coming up next to me, I just kind of stopped and he just went on, just went by. Yeah, you got those type of things. We worried about that a little bit, I must say.
So you just stayed in your car pretty much? Breaks?
I'm trying to think of what we do. We stayed at... parks that, you know, connect cars, you have electricity and everything there, you get that type of thing sometimes. And if we did go to a hotel, which we did sometimes, it would be in the ghetto. See, the ghetto except the whites.
Right.
conditions, that, you know, the flying the buttermilk syndrome when you got to San Francisco in the 60s.
Yeah.
Was there any kind of parallel scene for, like, black gays and lesbians, or when's the first?
Well, you know, it wasn't like black lesbians. It's like not like today at all. I mean, you know, we went to the white bars because that's all there was there to go to. There weren't black bars and things like that, you know. It was just, basically the gay community kind of accepted most of us, you know, because we knew that we were all underdog. And so we kind of stuck together in a sense. The guys would come to our bar, but we basically went to the guys' bars before they came to our bars. Yes.
I saw another documentary on Netflix about Janis. I don't recall hearing about you in that particular documentary. Do you think Janis would want to, her lesbianism to be public now?
Yeah.
I think she would now. I think she would accept herself now. But I think that she had been hurt so much by men that she was moving over closer to being a woman lover, you know? That's what I think. I don't think she would have been that happy with women, even to be honest with you. Because she was just a really sad, tormented person in her personality, a lot of times.
Can I ask you one more thing about the music? I wondered if there were other people that she may have, you know, turned you on to besides, you were talking about Bob Dylan. Maybe there were other records or other artists that you...
Well, the thing is, she didn't turn me on to any other artists, but I mean, I have been around other artists, but I said we had the Friends and Relations Hall. They used to be the old Family Dog. So Crosby, Stills and Nash, you know, Ray Slick, all these people that worked for us. I was around them because they were performing for us. And Bill Graham, he came over one time and says, well, why don't you let me put some money in this and we can really get this going? And we were afraid of that because we were afraid of him. So we didn't. But it's just as well because they took Bill down anyway. But maybe had he been involved, he could have done something to fight it or whatever. I don't know. In hindsight, I don't know.
So when the second wave of feminism, you know, the 60s, 70s, started, and Mods and Pegs and the Stops, and were you, and that was sort of the same time as the, so the hippie, the hippie, I mean, to be a hippie at Mods, now, all the old bar guys was like a sin. You know, we come in and say,
that's
leave
right.
The bars.
That's
you know,
right.
Yeah.
I used to get.
So did you
now?
Did you go to the one women's bar?
I did.
Okay.
And if I went to Mars, I would get chewed out because I didn't care who I played with.
That's right.
And they didn't want men to play on the table.
Oh.
You know, I said that's discrimination. Nobody.
Bradley's.
Right, Bradley's across the street. You know, but I didn't care, but they didn't like men playing on the table. They said, this is for women, and women don't play. I said, you're saying that women don't play as good as men. Well, most women don't, but, you know, I was just saying, hey, I can beat any man. Right.
So I'm wondering, were you aware of, like, Del Martin and Phyllis Lyon and the Daughters of Elitis, and the sort of
I just never got into politics in anything. You know, I just never did.
I mean, whether or not you were in politics,
but,
did
but
you
yes,
cross
I knew
your,
who they were.
You did,
you know,
okay.
Because they were coming to the bars. Yes. Yes.
The thing you said about Bill Graham just kind of being nosy, I guess. But why were you afraid of them?
Because he owned all the groups. And we had to really scramble and pay him money. money to have the Goose play for us. And so that's why we never made any money, because we were paying lights, paying the musicians, paying the fee for RAM, to let them play in place. You know, it was just money, money, money going out. And when we did Tawny, Peter Townsend sent us a telegram because apparently we hadn't gotten permission. And they said, you put it on one more time and take it to court. So we had to cut that down. That was after 2.5 months. I'm making Googles of money. Yeah. Yes.
So when you live in a campus, did you sing in the shower?
She sang everywhere. Yes, she did. She always was singing.
She sang in bed?
Well, I don't remember that. But I can't say she did, because I sing in bed right now. Yeah. Yes.
I've seen a flyer for like Sylvester performing at one of those places out, you know, out by the, you know, where Playland was.
Right.
I don't know if it was in the era that you were involved. Or...
I don't remember Sylvester playing for us. I loved him. Yeah, but
he didn't.
No, I don't think he did.
It was like kind of the, like just after the Cockettes era or something.
Yes.
I was struck by the many artist movements that you lived through. You were in New York, then you came to the Beat Movement, you saw the Summer of Love and its aftermath, and now you're still an artist. And I think I'm curious about, for us who didn't live through that, is there something that, some space in time that you would have loved all of us to have been there to have lived it?
I didn't understand the question.
Is there some time in kind of like an art space, an art time, like the Beat Movement, or back when you were in New York, that was special for you, that you think?
Well, to be honest with you, it all was special to me. Mm-hmm. Because I was living it. And it's just like your life right now. When you look back on it, it all will be special. You know, it's just where you are at the time that you're there. I'm coming up on 80 years old now. And I just got my girlfriend here about a year and a half ago. Look, either make it or we don't. It doesn't matter that much anymore.